but that we would learn to do the things that you want to do. And in so doing, walk in your will. Walk out the purpose that you've created us for in your kingdom. Lord, we want to make big waves for the kingdom. And we ask for your anointing. Lord, I just ask for your anointing to fall on each person here in an increased measure, that when we walk from here, when we go day to day doing the things that we do, we would walk with the light beaming out of us, just invading the darkness around, and not focusing on, oh, look at the darkness here, look at the darkness there, but focusing on you bringing the light in people's life, and you bringing deliverance and bringing freedom and bringing healing and just setting people free from the bondage of the kingdom of darkness. Lord, we just ask for more of that. Whatever that means. Maybe that's a scary prayer, but we pray it anyway. So Lord, just tonight we invite you, Holy Spirit, to speak, to convict, to bring to mind strategies and ideas, creativity, for us to walk out what you've called us to do. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so yeah, we're going to talk about covenant and kingdom as kind of two principles, maybe pillars in the Christian faith, and how they play out in our life. This is going to be a really short message. I wanted to keep it really simple because the intention for tonight is really to be thought-provoking. Not that we don't provoke in every message that we do, but I want to kind of prod you a little bit to take a little bit of what, it's like I'm going to throw you like a little thing that you need to take home and unwrap and take it apart and dialogue with the Lord about it. And that literally may look as simple as this just gets you thinking about something, and then through the week a thought comes to your mind and you're like, oh yeah, that's an idea, I never thought of doing it that way. So that's my intention for tonight. But we've been talking a little bit about thinking differently about what church looks like, right? You know, we've been talking a lot about that, and we're going to continue to talk about that. I'm not going to throw a program at you. I'm not going to throw a methodology at you or a formula or anything like that. But hopefully tonight gives you just some things to think about how maybe ministry looks in your life different perhaps than what you might have thought before. You know, we've been talking through the idea of these missional communities. It's kind of a buzzword in the church the last maybe, I don't know, 5, 10 years. 10 years would be pushing it, but well known for at least 5. It's not a new thing. It's 2,000 years old. Because Jesus walked around in a missional community. And I'm not going to unpack and go into all exactly what a missional community looks like. It depends on who you talk to anyway. But essentially, we're looking for a community on mission. Okay? That's what covenant and kingdom essentially is. But I want to narrow down and get a little bit more specific in the sense of how ministry maybe might happen. Okay, so let's take covenant first. We all know covenant is like a promise or an agreement, right? But in its most simple form, as far as covenant between us, God's people, also us personally, and God, it's relationship, right? So you take the marital relationship, and that's all based on covenant. It's based on we agreed and made this commitment, and that is what our relationship is based on, this commitment. And the same thing is true with us and God. Excuse me. If we go back, let's go back to the beginning. Now, we've talked a little bit about this in the past, but I think it's good to illustrate it again. God is three, and he's one. And that's one of the mysteries of the kingdom. It really makes no sense, but it makes total sense. So when God was creating, we have the Genesis account of creation, right? And you walk through the creation story. Isn't it interesting that it says God created man in his image, right? But the way he talks about it is interesting. Let me just look it up real quick, because I think it's, I don't want to butcher it. So this is going to take us all the way back to Genesis 1. If you want to find it, you can, but I'm really just going to read one verse. Okay, so verse 26. Genesis 1:26. Then God said, okay, so this is God speaking, one God, let us make man in our image. That's kind of weird, isn't it? So not only is God three and one, but he interacts with himself. Okay, so being made in God's image means that we are made for relationship. God in who he is, the very essence of who God is relationship. He is relationship. And I'd love to unpack some more sometime about the Trinity. It's very complicated and very simple at the same time, which again makes no sense. But the cool thing about the Trinity is the way God prefers different elements of who God is prefer each other, the persons of the Godhead, I should say. So the Father says it's all about the Son, and the Son says it's all about the Father, and the Holy Spirit says it's all about the Son. You know, it's a preferential relationship. We could learn a lot about relationships if we took that example. But let's get back on track, though. So we have God in his very essence being relationship. When he created everything, he created everything with that same idea that relationship is what is going to hold everything together. You know, even science would say, you know, the chair you're sitting on, the floor you're walking on, we don't fall to a heap in a puddle because of the atomic bond, which is the relationship between two atoms, right? So in the building blocks of everything of creation, you know, we see scripture says all creation speaks of the glory of God. So inherent in creation, we see that relationship is important, and we see it played out all through scripture. So we cannot downplay the significance of community and relationships, both with God and with each other. What are the two greatest commandments? The greatest commandment is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and strength. Okay, and then the second one is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. Again, that's relationship. Again, you can't get away from the importance and the centrality of Christ, him crucified, and the relationship that we're supposed to have because of that. So, we have covenant, which is essentially relationships, which is played out in many different ways, but when we look at the most intimate relationships, it's a family context, right? And Jesus left his natural family that he was raised in, and he created his own family, essentially the 12 disciples, right? Because there were many people that followed him. It wasn't just 12 disciples. There were lots of people that regularly followed Jesus, but he committed to 12. And then within the 12, he had three, Peter, James, and John, okay? And they had an even closer relationship than the rest of the 12. And then within the three, there was the one, John. No one had a relationship like him. I think in the coming weeks, I talked about this the other day, we'll probably get into a series on the levels of intimacy, and which is illustrated in the 12. Because there's things we learn about our relationship with God and maybe what he's doing and what's happening in our relationship based on where we're at. And it can help us understand how that progresses. But we see these levels of relationship, but the family unit in the Jewish culture was incredibly important. That's something that, unfortunately for us Western Christians, we don't have that mindset that they do. Everything was done in a family context back then. Everything was relational. Everything was circular. Everything was not like our left brain, linear, logical, makes sense, independent, self-made, all of these predominantly Western culture traits that we have really need to be dismantled, shattered, and we need to adopt a more biblical scriptural model, which is creative and organic, circular, not linear and relational. Even in what I believe would be a biblical leadership model, it's orbital in nature, not hierarchical, like we see in many organizations, even church organizations. So we'll set that aside for a second. And then we have the Great Commission, okay? There's clearly a kingdom of darkness and a kingdom of light. They're at odds with each other. And so you all know this. I'm just laying a foundation, okay? So we have a battle going on between these two kingdoms that exists and is ongoing constantly, whether we want to ignore it and say there's nothing going on, or whether we want to say, yeah, there's something going on. And our role in that battle, in that kingdom, is to be sons and daughters. So we have inherent responsibilities and rights and things like that that we get as sons and daughters. But essentially, Jesus gave us the Great Commission, and he says, go make disciples. So that's a pretty clear, cut and dry commission. But in addition to that, he says, cast out demons, cleanse the lepers, all this stuff. Which all of that, if you just boil it down to make it simple, it's just eradicating the dark kingdom. It's just saying, okay, I have a kingdom that's greater than darkness, so that lesser kingdom, move, the greater kingdom, we usher it in. It's that simple. That plays out a lot of different ways, but essentially, we have this mission, this kingdom mission that we're all called to. If you're a Christian, you are on a mission. Period. And so we all have different roles in that mission. We all have, it plays out differently based on our gifting, our calling, our makeup, our personality, all of those things. But here's something that I want to pose to you in question form. What would it look like if we did kingdom mission and family relationships at the same time? What do I mean? There's a well-known author and his wife. His name is Mike and Sally Breen. And they write about their experiences in ministry. They kind of more or less coined the term or developed the idea of what a missional community is. So they've lived this stuff. One of the things that they talked about is growing up in the West. They're British, but that's still Western culture. Growing up in a Western culture, they were getting married, they were going to go into ministry, and they thought, okay, what we see in the church right now is one or two things. Either a pastor has excellent ministry and their family sucks. Like they have no time for their family, their family's falling apart, they basically abandon them, but they have a great church, ministry, whatever. Or the opposite is true. Church isn't really growing, nothing's happening, they're not really doing anything, but they got a great family. And so they saw, okay, so we don't want to do family or mission. We want to do family and mission. So they decided, let's do this thing. We're gonna set healthy boundaries. We're gonna allot our time to these things in the correct ways. Again, this is linear thinking for you, okay? We're going to do ministry and we're going to do family. And they did that for about 10 years and found that after 10 years, they were still burned out and they still felt like something's still missing. And then through some revelation, through praying and reading scripture, looking at the life of Jesus a little more closely in that context, they realized, what would it look like to do family on mission instead of family and mission? And so then we see this integration happening, which is what this the Jewish culture, they picked it right up, you know, and partially it was because it was the only thing, the first thing to be introduced. It was, they were walking with Jesus, Jesus left, came back, and then left again, and they're like, oh, we're just going to do what we saw, and they did. But it was also in the context of their Jewish thinking, and so it was easy for them. For us, we have to think in our context, cultural context, and try and capture the essence of what they had that we are missing and put it into our culture. And so what would it look like if we start doing family on mission? So this means having, you know, a family focus in the sense of we're not neglecting our family. Family is actually part of what we're doing. So you have a family who has a mission and a mission who has a family. So it's a both and. And so I'm not going to unpack that much further than that. I just want to start provoking thoughts. I don't want to give answers. But in your life, here's the challenge. To pray and ask the Lord what it might look like. Well, first of all, pray and ask the Lord maybe what your family and your mission realities look like. Whether one's strong or the other's weak or vice versa or whatever, maybe they're both strong. But like, you know, Mike and Sally were sharing, like theirs both were strong and they were worn out. And then there's this disciple part. We're supposed to make disciples. Well, how do you make disciples if they don't see how you live? Because maybe you meet with some guys or some girls and you're pouring into them, but they never see how you treat your wife. They never see what you do when you're going to the grocery store. They don't see how you pump your gas. And they seem like menial things, but if you're walking a life in the kingdom, not, well, I'm a Sunday Christian or Saturday night, okay? If you're actually walking like a Christian, like Jesus did, you're seeing the kingdom advance everywhere you go. You're healing people while you're getting milk and bread. You're casting demons out when you walked past someone and they start growling at you because the light in you stirred up the darkness in them. And you're like, hey, buddy, let me help you with that, you know, or whatever that looks like. And so if you're not inviting family on a mission, then they're missing the most important thing, which is seeing you do what it is that you do. And it's twofold. Discipleship is being and also making. So it's maybe you're being discipled by someone and they don't really understand the importance of having you come along and do things with them. Maybe you say, hey, I know this sounds weird, but can I just like hang out with you more? Like, can I just go grocery shopping with you? Can I do whatever it is you do and just watch you? And that's a Jesus model. And the same would be true if you're discipling people. And so so I'm just inviting you to think about what it would look like for our life to be relational and to be missional at the same time. Something that I shared with the interns recently, and we're probably going to talk about this quite a bit. One of the things that this Mike guy developed is something called Life Shapes. And it seems kind of funny. But what they did was they created these geometrical shapes, and each shape means something and tells a principle. And the reason they did that is because, you know, you have a lot of, you know, a pastor will teach you like the three-step model for evangelism or the whatever. And half the people walk out and they're like, yeah, I get that. And half the other people are like, I don't even know what you just said. But with Life Shapes, it's simple. And it's something that you can remember and understand really easily. And you'll see what I'm saying here in a second when I share one with you. And one of the purposes for these life shapes is, we've talked amongst us many times about that we're at the beginning of a movement, right? Which means we are at the point where we're creating a culture. We have no culture influencing us except for all our shared cultures that we bring to the table. But we don't have a corporate culture yet. We're developing a culture. One of the things that they would argue is that language shapes culture. So you have part of your culture is commonly understood language that you use that everyone knows what it means. And so life shapes helps each person to understand a concept that is a part of your culture, and it makes sense. And then when someone says, how you doing with your triangle? Everyone knows what you mean. So I'll share with you the triangle, because probably the triangle is one of the most basic, elementary, foundational life shapes, and it actually helps a great deal as a check and balance in your life to see where you're at with some of the most important elements of your life. So the triangle, if you can picture, I don't have a cool one up here for you. The internet was down today, so. But for you geometry buffs, nerds, whatever you want to call them, what's an equilateral triangle? Each side and angle is the same, right? Am I right?
Yes.
I mean, I'm really not a geometry buff. So picture a triangle that is an equilateral. So every side is equal, every angle is equal. So the point here is balance and symmetry. So on the top point is up. Up is this, your relationship with God, okay? So intimacy with the Lord. On your right side would be in, which is this. People that know the Lord and your fellowship with them. And then on the other corner is out, which is us and our relationship with people that don't know the Lord. So all three of those should be in balance. If we're lacking in one, there's usually a reason for that, and